Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Season 2 of Beyond the White Noise Paranormal VidCast, Show Number 3. Tonight we have on author Darryl E. Barry Jr., also author of Travel Far. Tonight's show is going to be epic. It's going to be a little bit off the paranormal path, but back onto the paranormal path, off the paranormal path, back on the paranormal path. So
every week, but
I do want to welcome Darryl to the show. Welcome to, yeah. Thanks for coming out, Darryl, on a Sunday afternoon in our park.
Thanks for having me.
Past my co-host bedtime in the UK. So let's kick it off. Darryl, tell us about yourself.
Awesome. I started having out-of-body experiences when I was about 4 or 5 years old. And that's how I got initiated into the experience. So to me, that lends credence, amongst other things, of the reality of the experience. But basically what happened is I was feeling kind of heavy and lethargic, and I decided to go lay down until I felt better. It was around dusk. You know, it wasn't necessarily time for sleep, but it wasn't in the middle of the day. And I told my mom I was going to go lay down until I felt better. And so I went and proceeded to do that. And every time I took a step, I got heavier and heavier. By the time I got to my bed, I could barely stand up. I plopped myself on the bed and went to sleep. And at a certain period of time, I started to feel a lot better. So I figured I would get up and tell my mom I was feeling better, since, you know, she might have thought I was feeling sick or what have you. So I got up out of bed, and I went to walk to the door to exit to go to her. And when I went to open up the door, my hand went straight through the doorknob. So I went to try to open the doorknob again. My hand went straight through the doorknob again. And that was my introduction into the experience. When I turned back and I saw a lump on the bed that I recognized must be my physical body. And my adventure started from there.
Okay. And before Mo comes in with his questions also, I do want to ask you, how old were you when this actually took place?
I was about 4 or 5 years old. I don't remember exactly, but I'm certain it was around 4 or 5 years old.
And how old are you right now, if you don't mind my asking?
I'm 35. What am I saying?
All you guys are all young. I'm the old man here collecting Social Security. But what I do want to say, that's interesting at that age that you do remember back that far and stuff like that. So let me pass it on over to Mo. Go ahead. My co-host, Mo Gunnery.
Right, just one question. Hello, everybody. I haven't left for Cyprus yet, so you're just stuck with me for one more week. But before we go any further, when you had that experience where you grabbed and you grabbed through the doorknob and you turned around and looked at yourself, at that point, you, as you say yourself, you were 5 years of age. What the hell went through your mind when it happened?
Well, really, the only thing that came to my mind, probably because I was that age, was I need to get to my mom so she can help me, basically. So I tried to open up the door more than once, and my hand went through every time. So I decided, well, if my hand can go through the doorknob, I can probably get through the door. So I proceeded to walk through the door, and I proceeded to make a beeline straight through the walls and so forth. And I went to the kitchen and was trying to get her attention. So I noticed that I was trying to yell, but no sound was coming from my throat. But I was able to observe what she was doing for a while.
Yeah. Well, that's that must have been a lot to take in. That must have been a hell of a lot to take in. Now, the one thing I would, and a bit of a very simple question, but there is one question which, ever since I heard that you were coming on, I always wanted to ask. For you to have an OBE, or, as I said, is it more towards astral projection that you would call it? Or there's three types it could be. OBE, out-of-body experience, astral projection, or lucid dreaming. Where would you say that fell?
Good question. Well, the way I use the word out-of-body experience, it includes the word astral projection. So this is the way I look at it. An out-of-body experience is an experience where you experience yourself being separate from your physical body. Yes. What the word astral projection normally refers to is an out-of-body experience in a non-physical dimension. Yes. Lucid dreaming is something totally different from both of those. So a lucid dream, in my experience, is this. Let's say you're in your physical body, you go to get in an elevator. You have to go up 10 flights of stairs. So your mind starts drifting and you're daydreaming that you're on the beach somewhere. That hallucination is the same thing that happens when we sleep. When we're sleeping, we're just hallucinating. And when we become aware in that hallucination, that's what we call a lucid dream. But while you're having a lucid dream, your non-physical body can still be interpenetrating your physical body or hovering out of your physical body. So basically what we call the dream at night is a hallucination you're having while you're out of body and constantly hallucinating.
Right. Sorry, Kate, go.
Have you touched up on that in your book about what causes dreams, why humans dream?
Yes,
and the purpose of what's your take on that? I mean, I've heard many different, you know, theories on it, whether it's from scientists, whether it's from people that are into the metaphysical, and I'm trying to, you know, you try to put two and two together, but with something like that, you tend to get five, and you're wondering where that missing piece is. What's the purpose that why do humans dream? Dogs dream, other animals dream. So it kind of makes it's real interesting thinking about that. You know, as you see your dog on the floor yelping on its side, yeah, doing its noises. It's like noise, kind of like Mo does every night.
Sorry, what noise was that? I didn't get that. Sorry, can you start?
Noise. Okay, I just had to say that, Darryl. I apologize to you, my friend. But can you tell us why the theories out there? Why we dream to begin with?
In my experience, it's just mind wandering. It's no different than being in the elevator and you're going up to that 10th floor and you lose focus and your mind wanders and you see yourself on a beach. There's no purpose to that hallucination. It's just your mind wandering. So if you practice enough, you get conscious 24 hours a day to the point where you never lose awareness and you don't dream anymore because your mind is always conscious. So basically, whenever the mind becomes active and you're unfocused, we call that a dream. So it's just that what happens is when the mind wanders, we project what we think. We project what's in the inside. So that's why it's amenable to psychoanalysis and things. So it's not so much that dreaming, in my experience, has a purpose in itself, like there's some kind of universal purpose to why we dream. It's just that because we normally do it unconsciously, we can see what we dream and know what we're thinking. So it has a psychoanalytical use. But I don't think the act in itself is purposeless. I think it's just the mind wandering, you know. But just like Freudian slips, you know, you have a Freudian slip, which is to say, when you say something, you don't intend on saying, but it still reflects something that you're thinking deep inside. That's all it is. It's just your mind wandering, but it still reflects what's in your mind. So that's my take on it, based upon my experience. And again, I've had experiences where I practice a whole lot, and I don't dream anymore. I'm just conscious 24 hours a day. I'm either conscious in my physical body, or I lay down and my body goes to sleep, and I'm conscious in my non-physical. So dreaming is not an imperative. It's just what happens when your mind wanders. It's just a function of the unfocused mind.
It's a fascinating thing where dreaming's concerned, because, I mean, I'm not going to lie to you, I couldn't sit here and say to you that I was fully apt and aware of the dynamic behind dreaming, right? I've looked into astral projection in the past. I've looked into lucid dreaming, which we talked about before. I've looked into the experiments of OBEs by doctors, but they were like near-death experience OBEs. They weren't trained OBE. Yeah, NDEs. So, but it's like when somebody's, we'll say NDEs for that one. And it's easy for something like that to consume a person, literally to consume them, to take up a lot of the time, to take up. How much do you effort and time you put into the understanding of it?
Well, it depends on when I first started, because when I was a kid, it just happened naturally, and I thought everybody did it, really. So it wasn't a big deal to me after a certain point. But then when I started to become aware, it wasn't something that's so normal as I thought, and I realized I could explore different dimensions and things like that, I became really into it. So there was periods of times when that's all I pretty much did, was practice all the time. But, you know, you can only explore so much, and then after a while it became very purposeful.
And to tie into what you were saying there, it's become so natural for you. I'm thinking of, and this is where we take a little, not a detour, but just a little roundabout. We'll call it the roundabout in the middle of the highway. Psychics. I mean, do you consider that being kind of the same as, let's say, somebody coming out and saying, I'm a medium, I'm a psychic, I'm able to pick up this? Do you have that ability? Do you think you have that ability? Or is it totally something opposite, because you are involved in everything pretty much metaphysical, and that kind of falls underneath that umbrella right there.
That's a very good question. I would say not only does it relate, but I would say in a sense it's the same thing. Like, I've done channeling, I've done telepathy, I've done aura vision, I've done all of that stuff. And what I found is all psychic powers really have to do is with entering an altered state while remaining aware still of physical data. So if I'm looking at you physically and I'm able to slip slightly into an altered state around a theta range, I will start to overlay onto the physical world non-physical data, in which I'll see, for instance, auras. Or if I close my eyes and I go into a deep altered state, I'm able to access non-physical realms and then do things like channeling. So it really is all the same thing. It's a matter of accessing altered states and remembering the data. One very telling example of this is when I started to become aware of the idea of spirit guides, I started to practice what's called automatic writing. Like, I would sit down and I would just open my mind and write what comes. And I started accessing, like, I got this being called the One, which I've heard several people got in contact with. And then I got in touch with some things that was just gibberish. But eventually I got in touch with what seemed to be a very definite entity. And at the same time, I started to have experiences of seeing a being. As I would practice out-of-body travel, there's a state, a level called the theta state, and I would see this being showing me things. And I started to channel him. And what would happen is, let's say I would go into an altered state, and one time I went into an altered state, he gave me a lot of information, and he told me his name. And I knew I would remember his name when I came out of it, but every time I came out of trance, I completely forgot his name. So it took a lot of practice for me to be able to go into altered states and bring the information back. So all channeling is just going into altered states, which allows you to access what we call the hidden talents in humanity. Like, people talk about the human uses only 10% of the brain or 25% of the brain. That's because a lot of that, quote, brain power is only accessible when we go into the alpha, theta, and delta brainwave states. Okay. Right? So, for instance, remote viewers, they're doing that in a theta state. It's not anything really different, it's special, or the same thing with aura vision channeling, all of that stuff. It's just being able to access altered states consciously, which then allows you to bring the data back from those altered states. So that's my experience. So, like I said, I've done all of that.
Okay, with basically, I was going to go back, and I don't want to go back too far to automatic writing, but that kind of works on the same premise as the Ouija board does with the ideomotor skills. And my take on it is, and this is, okay, not this is not my co-host take, this is not your take, that a lot of this coming out is basically your subconscious bringing it out. I mean, can that be true in some cases, that you're so in touch with that extra piece of brain that, as you stated earlier, between 10% and 25%, do you think that a lot of times we're so far in touch with more or less our subconscious coming out with that, something you could have picked up elsewhere, or do you think it's a real being that you're actually channeling to write down, you know, went from gibberish to actual words to maybe conversations that you could have with the person that you've channeled?
Good question. In my experience, this is not either or. In my experience, it could be both. I think sometimes people channel and they actually channel different aspects of themselves. And I think sometimes people channel and they channel different beings. And in a sense, both of those experiences still has to go through yourself. So, in other words, if you're receiving a telepathic message, it still imprints upon your consciousness, and then you allow that to come through you. So really, in both ways, it'll, in a sense, you're getting your unconscious. But it is possible to contact a separate being. And for instance, I know Kenos was separate because I literally went out of body and saw him. I went out of body and saw him as a separate being, just like how I went out of body and seen other beings and confirmed it. So, you know, both, you know, so in my everyday life, you know, I practice spirituality and healing my mind of guilt and things like that. And I notice that as I do this more and more and I become more peaceful inside, that part of our mind that is this peaceful is allowed to work through me where, you know, for instance, I get less anger and I feel more sure about what to do about this or that. So that could be an instance of channeling. So channeling doesn't have to always be consciously going into an altered state. Pretty much any time we open ourselves to inspiration, that's channeling. So any time a person is writing a great musical piece and is so inspired, they're channeling. They're just channeling different aspects of their consciousness. But again, you could also channel a separate non-physical being as well. And, you know, in a sense, really, unless you have some kind of way to test that, there's no way to really confirm. Like, there's channelers like Darryl Uncle, who's a favorite channeler of mine. And he channels this being called Bashar, who's as he says, from an extraterrestrial race called Esasani. Now, you might say, well, how can you prove that's not his own mind? But he has actually seen the craft with people present. He's actually seen the craft that Bashar said, this is my craft, right? So the same thing with Okinos. I've seen him as a separate being. So, you know, if there's no way to validate it, I guess there's no way to be sure. But in my experience, it could be either.
Well, it's perfect for you as an individual, a time that you've decided to follow this as a study, especially what you were saying there about other world presence, for instance. But before I go on to that, one thing I will say is you were talking about the brain and its 10% capacity. There's a film which has been released as of late called Lucy, and in the film it goes from, she takes, if I remember correctly, a drug based inside, and she was like a human drug trafficker. Or drug mule, and a drug based inside. The next minute, brain capacity starts to go better and better and better, and she starts pushing for, or the brain starts pushing into percentage of limits of how it gets used. Now, when you look at that, that was a bit far-fetched as a film, but as a theory, it really is a good theory. We don't know, ultimately, we have no clue what the hell we're capable of. As individuals, we have no clue. So, with regards to, I mean, especially in the entire genre of the paranormal, all the fringe subjects that we follow, we always come across people who would say, and you have the naysayers and the skeptics who go, well, it's not possible, or it's just not feasible. Whereas, when you've explained it there, you explained it right. In my eyes, it was perfectly right. Is if we only use that little amount of our brain, there's so much more potential, I think personally, built into us that we should be able to use. Now, second question I do have to ask, you mentioned about him seeing, about the gentleman seeing a craft, okay? Now, the way that, well, NASA's actually, how can I put it, they've all of a sudden started up again, is the best way of calling it, and now they reckon they've spotted the planet local to us at the moment, which has, they're calling it Earth 2.0, which they reckon has not sign of life, not even close to sign of life. I think it's within 2 light years of us or something like that. And it's capable of sustaining life, or it's got water, or you can see it's got an atmosphere, basically. And they've spotted this, apparently, by the way. So even science is changing its thought on what we are capable of, what the universe is capable of, what is out there. They're now, they're even looking into creating black holes to see if they can manipulate time or manipulate gravity. The gravity then, it's manipulated time, sorry. So I can see exactly where you come from, but science seems to be coming onto your side now, if you get what I mean.
And I do.
It's kind of a weird thing to explain, but if science is coming onto your side now, do you think more people are going to look into this as a field, or do you think it's still going to stay the field that it is now, where only a select few people look into it?
In my experience, all of the above, right? In my experience, there's not just one timeline. And different people, everybody can experience what they want. So one of the reasons why I'm delving into it is because I want to make sure that I align myself with a world that's going in that direction in whatever way. So to condense that into one timeline, I would say, yes, the world is getting to a point where it become more and more profound and more and more pronounced in our society. Because it's just the next, I mean, the only way our technology will make a sufficient enough leap to be able to traverse space is to start to become aware of consciousness as an aspect of our being, as an aspect of existence. So, you know, a lot of you were mentioning these craft, you know, if these beings who come from 1,000 light years away traveled at the speed of light, it will take them 1,000 years. So obviously, how they're getting here, they're able to do things like take their craft and change it into different dimensions, move outside of the constraints of time and space and then come back into this dimension. And they do that from an understanding of consciousness and interfacing consciousness with technology. So it's inevitable in order for us to continue to progress as a society and a species into an interstellar society that we start to become more aware of consciousness and the validity of consciousness, the reality of consciousness, and eventually start to make our technology interface with consciousness, which is already starting to happen, where you see people starting to make prosthetics that move according to thought. There's the artist
to make fiber planes
that so we move in that direction. I mean, you know, based upon my research, they already have technology that interfaces, whether it's the down craft or stuff they retrograded or the stuff they figured out themselves. But it's just you know, more and more starting to come into the forefront. But I say we shouldn't wait for them. I say we should delve into it ourselves and make a new world ourselves and take it by the reins.
I've got one. I'm not going to contest what you're saying, but the one thing I have, which is a really big worry, is right. Have you ever heard the wow signal?
Had a what?
Okay.
Have you ever heard of the wow signal?
The wow signal?
Did you get that?
No.
Yes.
Oh, like the signal that's supposed to come from space.
What it was is
like from ETs.
What it was, there was a signal that was, as a society, we've been broadcasting since the 70s, and we've been sending a signal, or at least a pulse tone, out into space, to deep space, to see if anybody bites. It's like fishing. And all of a sudden, this scientist who's been sitting there at this, like an observatory, he's sitting there, and he's watching this piece of paper with this stupid little graph. And I'm sorry, no, it was numbers. And they had to look for a specific set of numbers, like a few threes and a zero or something together. And then all of a sudden, the wow signal appears, and he writes wow on it. And basically what it was it was something.
It was
a signal returned.
But now, it was a satellite. They actually, to follow with what Mo's saying, they actually re-looked at it again, that the return signal, and figured out you could pull it. It was just a satellite they mistakenly picked up.
And
Yeah, so it wasn't the actual being
the wow signal.
Yeah.
But it opened up a can of worms, because Stephen Hawking then in turn starts looking at, I mean, I don't know how deep into the extraterrestrial theory you actually are, Darryl, but it's one of those things where I do have an interest in it. I don't have an active interest in it, but I do have a heavy interest where I will research when I'm not doing a million and one other hobbies that I've got. Now, one of the things I did notice was Stephen Hawking, when he heard about the wow signal, he pretty much called some scientists idiots and said, how stupid are you? You're sending a message out to a society that you know nothing about. You're dropping a pin on us and saying, we're over here. How dangerous can you be? And SETI, the same with SETI. SETI have been sending a signal for a very, very long time, trying to contact what's there. And trying to drop a pin on us and say, we're over here, do you want to come and talk? When, theoretically, species, interspecies, doesn't normally seem to get on. So even if there was, theoretically, something otherworldly, I would, other than the fact they must look at us like an ant farm, that's the only reason I could ever think that anybody from outside of our planet would actually be bothered with us. We're kind of happy destroying ourselves.
Yeah, it's but going back, to tie into what Mo was saying, into what Darryl, you were saying the exact same. My question is, kind of from my side, is with, you know, the signals and all that, but with what you do personally, do you run into a lot of issues with different religions? Because, you know, for example, both Mo and I are Catholics, baptized Catholics-ish, or Catholic-ish, as we like to say. Do you ever run into any disagreements? Because, you know, with a lot of religions, it's black and white. Heaven, hell, purgatory for, you know, a lot like Mo and I. But do you ever run into issues with that when you do talk to people who do just believe in one God over the universe and stuff like that? I mean, because your theories are just so interesting, but do you see that a lot of religions tend to be a little more closed-minded about your message and about what you do and what you've experienced and this like that? That's just my interest or my question about how some religions will try to squash exactly where you're going, which is the way the science, as Mo was saying, science is making its way in your direction. Do you get any negative feedback from people that are religious?
When I try to talk to my friend who's sort of religious, I do get some negative response back, so I don't try to talk to him about it anymore. No one ever really brings that conflict to me because normally I'm talking to people who's already interested in it. But I kind of touch on that just for a second in my book by pointing out the fact that in the Bible, if you look at a lot of the things that they experience from the perspective of an out-of-body experiencer like John, he was in the spirit before he saw what he saw in Revelations. There's mention of the cord, the silver cord that breaks that debt. There's another part of the Bible that talks about whether he was in the body or out of the body. I know not. And I kind of just mention that and say, you know, if you think this is a conflict of religion, there's a case that can be made that with reference to it is in the Bible. And if it's a natural part of our being, meaning, you know, when I was a kid, I wasn't reading the devil's books. Like some people say, oh, it's the devil or whatever. I was just a little kid who just happened to, it just happened to happen to. You know, it's like people who have near-death experiences, they get hit by a car and then they're out. So if it's a natural part of our being, how could it be really be against God? And unless you say God made a mistake. So I don't think they can have it one both ways. I think you either have to say God made a mistake and this is happening, or it must be a natural part of our being. So I'm not religious myself personally. But just to touch upon that for the religious people, that's my answer. You know, it's kind of mentioned in the Bible, and it's a part of our natural makeup. I started doing it as a kid, so I don't see how it's against God. Now, the fact is, if you have enough out-of-body experiences, you learn that the afterlife is not how religion says. You know, I mean, that's just a fact. You know, there's no heaven and hell. There's many different dimensions. I went and I've met people that have died. I know that's just not the way it is. So it's going to be kind of hard holding on to the cookie cutter version of religion and start having out of body experiences. That's going to be very hard to do because it's just the evidence does not correlate, you know. And to touch upon what Maurice was saying as well, let me just say I'm very deep into ETs. Around the same time I started having out of body experiences, I started to become aware of contacts. I've had contacts since I was a kid. As I got older, I mentioned going into meditation. I've telepathically reached out to beings and have had sightings, and I'm going to have contact again. So I'm certain beings are here. In my research, I found that signals have come back. I believe there was a sort of a diagram that was sent out with one of the satellites, and we received a crop circle that seemed like a response from that. I've also heard of them getting a signal, and I believe that SETI is going to get a signal eventually. But really, it's sort of like us trying to call the 1800s with a cell phone. You know, the beings that we're trying to contact, the technology doesn't work on the same frequency. So most beings we will not be able to reach in that way, but some of them we do. Now, as far as Stephen Hawking saying that we have to worry about these beings, I think the statements he makes is one of the examples of how very smart people could be kind of dumb at times. Because, if you look at a being who has the technology to traverse thousands of light years of space, and because the fact is they're here. You can look at enough videos, you can see that they're here, you can do enough research, and from my own experience, if you telepathically called out to them, they will show themselves to you, they're here. So if a being was that advanced and it was like us, we would be dead already. You know, when the Europeans came to America, the Indians felt it immediately. When the Europeans went to Africa, they felt it immediately. So what we're doing is we're taking our own disposition and projecting it onto these ETs. It's called projection. They're not like that. So in my interactions with the ETs, as well as the fact that we're still here, they don't want to destroy us. They're here already. Matter of fact, there was a 2-mile-wide craft that flew over the entire state of Arizona. We're still here. So if they wanted to destroy us, we wouldn't be here already. So, you know, there's very much benevolent beings here, especially when you look at the fact that several craft have flown over nuclear bases and turned off the missiles. So some of them are even protecting us from nuclear destruction simply because that nuclear destruction would have an effect on other beings. So they would let us destroy ourselves to the point that it starts to affect species unlike us. So I don't think that's a worry at all.
I'm glad you touched on the ET theory, because I'm really going to drag Kate out of his comfort zone just because I can. Sorry, Kate. But where the extraterrestrial theory is concerned, a lot of it is based on the fact that people seem to think there is one breed slash species out there that are looking out at us. Now, the one thing I like to believe, and this is my own personal opinion, is that if something is there, it's one of three types of, let's say, being. Right? It is either an outsider looking in, okay? It's either us after evolution, further on ahead, coming back, if it's possible, or third, it's something which runs parallel to what we live now. Now, there's only realistically three ways in my head I can think it could be. I'm narrow-minded in believing that there's only one species, because to be fair,
there's billions.
Infinite is infinite. We don't even know how many species we've got on our own planet at the moment. That is a genuine 100% problem we've got. People are finding species of different animals all the time. We don't put down the bottom of the Mariana Trench.
Well, Mo, do you consider, and Darryl, do you consider, let's say, you know, the Mars rover, they're finding water supposedly on Mars. I'm giving you an example. Let's say there's an amoeba in that, and they find a frozen amoeba in that water. Do you consider that another species, or are we better than them, or are we to consider ourselves above them just because it's a little amoeba, or do you look at it as just three things? Because they're saying, also scientists are saying these days, there are millions and millions of universes. We just tend to think this is our universe, but they're so spread out, it could be infinite. In our minds, when we think infinite, it honestly scares the hell out of people, because that's forever and ever and ever and ever. I mean, with that, I mean, that kind of, I don't know. I'm just looking at it like that, and I'm not trying to debunk Mo's theory one bit. No, I'm really not, Mo. But it made me actually think. Mo sometimes makes me think sometimes, and believe it or not. But Darryl, what's your take on that?
I mean, I think we should respect all life. I mean, I think that's why we project destruction and hatred on them, because we don't respect all life. We find a person who is basically like us, but skin looks differently. We want to kill them or enslave them or take what's theirs. So, I believe that if we find whatever we find on Mars, and I believe that we're all on Mars. I mean, I can't prove it, but I believe that humans are there right now, just that these people in these space programs are not telling us about it. Let's say we go there and we find whatever, I think we should treat it as respectfully as we can. Now, I still think that we should recognize consciousness as primary. So, for instance, plants are life, but still we have to eat something or else we will die. So, I think it's fair to be practical and, recognize the chain, of life and everything like that. But just because something is there, I don't think we should kill it. But I mean, in my experience, I think we're already there, and based upon everything I found, I think life actually migrated here from Mars. Well, I think humans are there right now.
Well, we have the ability as humans to project on other humans. And I'm going to take this into account of, and I'm just going to stick with American history, as some of the slave owners did. They enslaved others to do their work for them. So they're already projecting their way of life onto somebody who, let's say, we'll talk about a point in time where it was legal to bring slaves in from Africa before it was banned in the United States. We were projecting the white aristocratic way onto another group of people that buy that.
We've done it in France. We've done it in France as well. I mean, I know a lot of French people, I can say we because my name's Maurice, it's Maurice, it's embarrassingly French, but we've done it over there as well. We sort of segregated ourselves and tried to force ourselves back over onto the people. And you know what? That's our own stupid fault. We are the idiots. I always say something that annoys my wife, right? I always say, I want off this planet. I always say it. Every time I get a bit tense about something, I say, do you know what? People, idiots, I want off this planet. And I sort of... That's the best way to put it. And the reason for that is, I think, as a society of people, we are collectively idiots. 100%, every single one of us. We consume too much, we destroy everything around us, we'll stand on bugs, insects, because it's nothing, because they're there. We'll rip a tree down, we'll kill a chicken because it tastes nice fried. For instance, I've just been to KFC. There's so many things we do as a society which we shouldn't really, we should be a little bit more thoughtful about. So if I was an outsider and I came down and, just say for saying sake, I decided I'm going to watch this planet like it's The Sims, Like, it's the same game. I'd look at this and think, they're a lost cause. I wouldn't even bother. I'd take but maybe chance thing, to
though.
Go.
This is the thing, though. Like, when you look at the Pleiadians, like, yeah, some of the best information I find from the Pleiadians is from Lisa Royal, or there's that guy, yeah. Billy Meyer. Mm-hmm. The Pleiadians, according to the Pleiadians, we all come from the same source race. You know, we all, you know, the human race in all these different variations is really from one race that comes from Lyra. Yeah. And they've had a history of warring as well. So I think the beings that come here, they don't look at us in that sense because they recognize that's where they come from.
Maybe
you know,
so.
Just like how an adult, you know, we don't look at our children and say, oh my gosh, this child is an idiot. He thinks that doll is important. You know, yeah. That stuff isn't important, but he's a kid. So you let him, you allow him his childhood because you know eventually he's going to grow up and then he'll attend to adult things. So I think that's the way they see us. They see us as, it's always like looking at their past. As a matter of fact, several people here will someday incarnate in the Pleiadian civilization or in the Assassinian civilization. So a lot of it also has to do with them coming back to themselves. So I don't really think, I think they recognize we have growth to make, but it's from a perspective of love, a perspective of recognizing that we are where they were and we will be where they are. So, you know, I just try to work on myself now.
No.
You know, I just try to work on myself and try to get rid of my own guilt and anger and hatred and desire to attack and desire to control and try to align myself internally with the kind of world I think this should be. And I think that's the best thing we can do. And either we'll end up on a planet in the future that reflects the way we think it should be, or we can one day incarnate on a different world that matches the kind of planet we want to have, which really has to do with the kind of person that we are. I mean, as much as we see how horrible this planet can be at times, we all are here, which means we must have some part of us that relates and correlates to what this planet is. So really it's about us working on ourselves so that we no longer align with this way of thinking.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm not ignoring you right now. You've just touched on a subject there, and I'm just trying to find it. There was two ancient civilizations which were destroyed. And I don't know, I've seen it once mentioned on Ancient Aliens. I know one's the rise and the fall of the Nephilim, the Nephilim being the fall. No, that was a theory, but somebody who came down from the heavens. And there was another one, it's Chariot to the Gods, Eric von Daniken's book.
I can't remember
who it was about.
I'm
trying to remember. Do you remember the name of the race? Oh my god, it's
brilliant. Anunnaki. Somebody, Anunnaki.
Google and the crappled. The Anunnaki, that's perfect, right? Yeah, the Anunnaki came down, they gave us advance warnings, we built everything for them, they gave us advance warnings that we were going to destroy pretty much ourselves, and then all of a sudden, we disappeared. And you've got places like Pumapunku, and there's a place just outside of Pumapunku where it was literally, it was engulfed by ash, there was a volcano, and they haven't found, unlike when what happened in, was it Peru, not Peru, the place that got covered by the ash. My brain's broken today.
Pompeii.
Sorry, Peru. Where am I going? When Peru got covered with ash, there's fossilized remains of people. Now, over in just outside of Pumapunku, it happened the same. It was ash fell, and they never found a single fossil or single skeleton there. So they think that somebody had advanced warning and got off. And it's the same as the Anunnaki, and the same as the Nephilim. Those types of they came down. They tried to help. Couldn't help, warned us and got out of Dodge, basically. And it's sort of those types of something coming down from above, it really strengthens your theory. And I mean, my personal opinion, again, as I said before, about the 10% of mental capacity actually getting used, or 10% of brain power getting used, and you've got the extra 90%, there's too much, all of it involved not using your brain enough. Obviously, not using your brain enough to look into things, not using your brain enough to think whether it's possible to project, not using your brain enough whether to believe that there is something extraterrestrial, thinking that, being closed-minded enough to say that this doesn't happen, it doesn't exist. It's all quite naive of us as a society, but I'll still stick to my guns. I do think that if there was, this is, again, only my personal opinion, I do think that if there was a society out there looking at us, I don't think they'd feel very helpful towards us. Not, I don't think they'd attack us. I do believe that maybe you might look at us and think, well, they're destroying themselves. It's just the way personally I look at it. It's sad.
I don't really think anybody should believe that. I really think that you should test it. I really think you should research the accounts of people who have had contact and initiate contact yourself. And just in my experience and observation, they don't see us as a lost cause because they know, you know, the way Bashar put it from the Esasana civilization, he said, if you were going to destroy yourselves, we wouldn't even be talking to you right now. Now that's the way he put it. So, yeah. You know, so, I think the fact that beings are visiting here and trying to help is evidence of the fact that there are timelines of Earth that will make it. Now, there are timelines that won't, but I intend to either be on the timeline that makes it or leave this planet, either on an ET craft or Ascension or something. Now, and I want to make sure I clarify something about the brain. Now, notice I mentioned that a lot of that missing brain power is in the altered states as well. So in my experience, it's not that we're sort of chained to using a certain percentage of our potential. I think it's a choice. I think it's denial. So I think at any point in time, we can take stock of ourselves and apply ourselves and become more aware of things like the out-of-body experience and practice it. Become more aware of seeing auras and practice it, and then we start to make manifest all of these different abilities. So, you know, I don't think there's anything that's necessarily locked away. I think it's things that we've been denying so we can hold on to our sense of separation. Like I was telling you about my friend who I tried to talk to sometimes. You know, once we finish this, if you have enough out-of-body experiences, you know, even though I still view myself as a body most of the time, but I recognize that if I was to get out of body at the highest level I can, and you get out of body at the highest dimension you can, we're the same with consciousness. Yeah, so that totally eradicates racism because we recognize that.
Go ahead. We're the same. We're basically the same. I have a heart, you have a heart. I have eyes, you have eyes. I drink water, you drink water. We're the same. But culture is what I think people misinterpret as when it comes to that. Like, oh, my culture being white middle class versus, let's say, white lower class. You know, we look down upon, let's say, people that live in trailer parks. But aside from that, I think also with technology is kind of leaving that thought process that you have, Darryl, behind, not behind in a positive way, but behind in a negative way, because we get so caught up in the minuscule things of our daily lives that could, like me, for example, misplacing my wallet, misplacing my cell phone, could drive me into a panic. That, or Mo coming home, having to, after working all day, he has family. He's focused on that. It kind of takes away from our ability to take that time out to actually learn how to meditate, how to take things at a calmer pace, how to get in closer touch with your own mind. I think with technology has outpaced our thought process with that 10%. And I've talked to different doctors about that, and I have brought that up, and they were in agreement that sometimes, you know, our technology, we're further behind than where our technology is today, and we're so tied into our laptops, we're so tied into, let's say, a show like this, that, you know, the time that I could be taking out to meditate, the time I could be taking out to just ponder a little bit, think a little bit more, think about the dimensions that are out there, and I am a believer in multiple dimensions, that I just think we're going to lose it to technology, because your average person on Wall Street walking out of their job is going to be on their phone going like this. The average person walking home from work is going to be talking on their phone. You know, so I think more people need to delve into this, get in touch with your consciousness thing, than what is actually happening.
I agree with what you're saying, and I agree with that perception. And I'll add this. I would say all of that is true, but it's not the cause, it's the effect. Like, for instance, with myself, I was so caught up in several things. And after the book came out and I started practicing again, and I have a research study going where I'm getting people who can get out of body, and we're meeting, and we're going to confirm things and things like that. And I simply changed my life so I can have more time to practice. So, you know, I don't think that it's technology that's sort of doing anything to us, because we make technology. We build technology.
Yeah. Well,
everything we make it to be. There's nothing here. There's no piece of technology that's not what we make it. And I have a cell phone. You know what? I decided to put it down to meditate. So I would say it's a choice. I would say all of that is true, but it's just that it's our choice. So, you know, what I just try to do is just focus on myself more. And I find once I started to do that, I started to align more with people who have that way of thinking. So what I really think is happening is right now we're at a nexus point on the planet. And what's going to happen is different people are going to experience their own Earth. Because as you said, I don't just believe that there's alternate timelines. I know that there's alternate timelines. You can go out of body and you can visit alternate timelines, and you can see the alternate playing out of events, and it's just as real as this timeline. So in my experience, I know for a fact that everyone can experience the kind of world that they want. So yeah. If you look out at the world and you see a world of hustle and bustle where people are not focusing on everything, it's because you're the same way, which you said. You said, I'm doing so many things and I could be meditating. So I guarantee if you look at yourself and start to eliminate the unnecessary out of your life and start to inject meditation and study in that place, you will start to look at a world and see more people who are doing that. And gradually you will start to align with the timeline whether at least it's possible to do that. But even if you don't switch timelines, in your experience, you will have more time. So I think it really all comes far to the self. You know, a good example that I found is, and I don't have anywhere to verify this story, but, you know, it illustrates the point. Like, apparently there was a program that the United States military made where they were starting to integrate consciousness direction into their fighter craft to try to make the craft more responsive as they start to get better and better technology, where a person doesn't have to fiddle with controls. And it would put some kind of monitor thing on the person's head. But what happened is one of the pilots almost crashed because, you know, he had an argument with his wife earlier or whatever, and his mind was not focused, and he lost control of the craft. Well, what happened is they started to teach the pilots meditation. And in order to calm themselves so they can be focused and calm and to task. But what happened is when the pilot started to learn how to meditate and they became calm and focused, they no longer was interested in blowing people up with fighter planes, and they dropped out of the program, so they had to scratch the program at that particular time because they couldn't get pilots who were adept at meditation who still wanted to murder. And so that, in my experience, go ahead. Mm-hmm.
I was just going to say, to tie in with what you were saying, the pilots meditating, I think, we're very old. We're young still when it comes to however you look at whether it's creationism, whether it's evolution. We still have that fight or flight syndrome. Now, if I'm going to go into combat at 35,000 miles at Mach 2.5, my fight or flight is going to come in. So I must have to be a meditative guru in order to realize I'm going this fast, this high. Now, if that person outflanks me in a dogfight, I'm done. You know, I mean, I think that our natural, you know, fight, you know, our feelings of fight or flight kick in. So, I mean, I think that's a lot of the part where the, you know, the technology can't override our fight or flight syndrome.
Well, I mean, with him, it was just that.
Go ahead, Mo.
No, go ahead. Finish what you're saying. So, you know what? Somebody's just put something in the chat room. I'm just going to keep going where you're going, and then when you're finished, I'll put it to you.
Well, what that is it was really just, because, I mean, if you look at the fact is people can fight and successfully fight, even with that fight or flight.
Yeah.
It's just that all of the turmoil inside doesn't automatically translate to their hand so quickly where they crash or they're using a joystick. It's just that neural interface was such a direct read that that's what caused the difficulty. But what they found was that a person who really got into a quiet state, they didn't want to fight anymore. So, I mean, the fact is, I mean, there's some soldiers today who they want to go back to Iraq or wherever so they can shoot people up.
Yeah.
So you can handle a gun and handle a plane wanting to kill people and being angry and stuff like that. But you can't be angry and murderous while being peaceful inside. So that's why I say it always comes back to looking towards the inside and changing our inner self so that we can, and the effect will change. I don't really see the fact that, like, I believe it was, I believe Einstein was quoted as saying, our technology has surpassed our humanity or something of that effect. Mm-hmm. But I see that as a choice. So I think as we individually make the choice, like I think Gandhi was quoted as saying, be the change you wish to see in the world. So if we look at the world and see technology outstripping humanity and outstripping spirituality, am I allowing that to happen with myself? And then if we change our own personal selves so that we put our inner development above technology and above the latest thing, you know, stand against the Joneses, then at least we can show that it's possible. You know, at least we can show and be an example that it's doable. And at the very least, we'll be able to be happier ourselves. Like, one thing I noticed when I started to cut out the non-essentials, because I used to look at hours of movie a day and hours of sitcoms a day, and nothing's wrong with doing any of that. But I realized I didn't have any time to meditate. I didn't have any time to practice. But as I started to cut that stuff out, and now I meditate and practice at least an hour or two a day, and I'm starting to get out of body again, and my non-physical perceptions are opening up again, and it just feels good. And really, I don't really care if anybody else does it, you know, because I learned long ago that if I try to change other people, it doesn't work anyway. So now I just gave up. But I find that if I do it, I'm happier, and I'm starting to get in contact with more people who are into the same thing. And even people who wasn't before, like there's three people in my research study where we're starting to get out of body and meet each other and stuff. And I'm starting to notice that I'm starting to be surrounded more and more by people who think the same. So really, I think it all has to do with the individual, and the world is the effect. And at the very least, our personal world will change. But ultimately, it's possible that our world as a whole, our external world as a whole, can change as well as a result. And I had actually closed the chat to make sure my speed was good on my
It's okay. Video. I've got it open. Don't be worried. Question in the chat room is, you were talking about a fighter pilots and neural control. And the fair thing, the gentleman you've communicated with in the past, Stephen Foy, the lad who's been talking to you in our chat, off our Facebook Messenger, he's a massive conspiracy buff. And the second you said that, he just typed out MK Ultra. The first thing you typed out, is it MK Ultra that you were talking about?
No, I wasn't talking about MK Ultra. I was talking about something totally different. It was literally a program that the military wanted to use to just have an interface between the craft and the pilot. Much like how nowadays they're making prosthetics. I just saw a video the other day where they put this plastic, you know, interface on the person's torso, and there's sensors on the person's arm where the person's thoughts, the nerve endings go to the sensors, and he could actually move the robot arm. So that's all it was. It was just, instead of a robot arm, it was the plane going left, right, up, and down, gun shoot. That's all it was. So it's totally right different from the MK Ultra program. Huh?
It is the... I know the technological advances that we make as a society, I think what we need to do is we need to... And this is my personal opinion. I'm going to actually agree with you on this one. I think sometimes we just need to put down the technology. We need to turn off the television, because we spend our life staring at a square box. We spend our life staring at more square boxes. There's always something. There's three screens in front of me. There's a screen in front of each one of you guys. Now, does that make you aware of what's going on around you? When you turn your TV off at night, does your ears ring because you're constantly used to hearing the hustle and bustle of life? And meditation can't affect negatively, as far as I'm aware. Now, I've heard of meditation affecting people negatively. But that, again, is when you go into meditation in a negative state in the first place. But obviously meditation sounds like it's really a huge part of what you do, and especially with the research that you do. So did you find out that meditation would help you with your research, or did you meditate and then your thoughts? Which way did it work for you?
I guess I would have to say it came from trial and error first, because when I was a kid, and one of the things that used to happen was I used to spontaneously fly at night. And I used to want to repeat that experience because I had it. It was so enjoyable. So what I began to do was lay down as I went to sleep and visualize myself flying, which I later found out to be a technique. And over the years, I started to read. I've read dozens and dozens of books. I think there's like 150 books in a bibliography of travel for. And I started to learn about a lot of techniques. So then I started to meditate to deepen it. So I would say it went both ways. Meditating helps you get into altered states. And the out-of-body experience happens at the deep altered state of delta. Basically, you go into deep delta sleep, but you remain conscious. You get into the theta state, which is a state of sleep that we call the hypnagogic state, where you see images and things. You can roll out-of-body and separate from that point, but once you separate, you go into delta. So I learned that meditation helps you get into altered states, and if you get into a deep enough altered state, you can initiate the out-of-body experience. So again, both ways, from trial and error and from research and learning how people do it and practice.
Well, okay, back to what I was saying about the safety of it, more to do with the safety of the outer body experience itself. How is it, could it go wrong? Can it go wrong for you? Is there a switch that you can flick to get yourself back out? It sounds weird, but is there a way? Do you have to know a technique to get in and a technique to go out, or can you literally just go back?
It's not a real question, and it's a good question. In my experience, you can't possibly get lost. Over the years, I've taught dozens, if not hundreds, of people how to have out-of-body experiences, and invariably, you're fighting to stay out. Invariably, it's difficult to get out initially, or it's difficult to stay away from the body, and you automatically get pulled back in. So you will have a harder time staying out than getting back in. And as you start to practice more and more, you can get farther and farther away. And the farthest I've went is about between 200 and 400 light years away. And getting back is still just a thought. So it doesn't matter how far you go away. You can be on the other side of the planet, or you can be light years away. It's still a thought to get back, because you're not physical, so you're not bound by time.
Right. Perfect. We've just had one amazing question appear in the chat room, and I'm surprised I haven't thought of it myself yet. Could this be the reason that some mind-altering drugs such as LSD are illegal to stop us achieving the right state of mind? So like LSD, ayahuasca, dimethyltryptamine, drugs like that. For instance, do you think that maybe not that they're kept away from us to stop us achieving the right state of mind, or maybe that they can help us achieve the right state of mind? What's your theories on that?
No, I can answer both of those. The first one, I don't think that they're being kept away for that reason, because I'm totally starting to get away from the victimhood idea. Oh, they're doing this to us, or they're holding us back. I don't think that's the case. I really think, just like with technology, all of that stuff is the effect. So the reason why people are so focused on the cell phone and the job and getting the car is because they don't want to look within. Because the fact is, one of the things you find when you look within is pain. One of the things you find is the pain of your past mistakes and the pain of whatever, and you have to deal with that. So all of that stuff is purposive. The reason why people focus on the technology is purposive. And if somebody really wants to have altered state experiences, they don't need LSD. You could just sit down and meditate at any time, and you can have those experiences. Now, I do believe that they can be helpful, because anything that disrupts your normal functioning can help get you into an altered state. I find it to not be the best way to do it. You know, I find it to be the best way to do it naturally. But, you know, do I think it's some kind of government conspiracy? No. And again, they couldn't stop it anyway. All you have to do is just sit down and practice yourself. And in my experience, you can have, you know, I've read about ayahuasca experiences and LSD experiences. Yeah. And I've had experiences that trumped all of that. I've had experiences that correlate. So I could see how it can be helpful, but you know, just taking ayahuasca once a year is not going to compare to meditating every day and getting to the point where you can start having at-will experiences. And what's that both? I think you asked, does it help, and was it secretive? Yes, I think that answered both of them. So it can help, but I don't recommend.
So would you say, and that's one thing I'd never recommend, is I've never in my life recommended any individual on the planet, and this isn't me pulling off a disclaimer, I don't think it's a wise idea for people to take drugs to try and help them change their perspective. The only time I've ever thought of it is there was dimethyltryptamine, a derivative, if I remember correctly, from mushrooms, and what they try and do is they're trying to find a way of getting dimethyltryptamine. The DMT, they call it, they're trying to get it for terminal cancer patients to help them with their physical perspective on dying, as opposed to looking at it and thinking, Jesus Christ, I'm going to die. You look at it and it sort of twists your perspective after one course, I think it is, where you go, not Jesus Christ, I'm going to die, but right, I know I'm going, I need to make peace with people, I need to make sure I'm doing this, and you look at it from a different angle. Now, that is a mind-altering drug, which obviously, apparently, when it's given in the right dosage, can actually make your perspective better. And I'd assume LSD must be its bad brother. you know, the delinquent child who wants to make your perspective worse, because I've heard a lot of people a bit more bad than good from using that, because it's still classed as a hallucinogen. It's not something which is ever a proven effective right way to do it, whereas with meditation you are still in control. So meditation again must just be the right way to do it. But even meditation, as I've said before, even meditation can be negative if you go in with the wrong mindset. I've heard of a few people who've gone into meditation, deep meditation, and it hasn't been a very good experience for them at all.
In what sense, Mo?
No, if you go in with a negative, put it this way, if I'll actually put this as a question as opposed to a statement. Have you ever had a negative out-of-body experience?
Yes, I had. When I was a kid, I used to be chased all around by this non-physical being every night. And I think because, so all of this stuff is really the effect, even though it's experience as the cause. So this non-physical being used to chase me. And eventually I ended up beating him up when I got tired of him and he left me alone. But I used to watch the Freddy TV series. And he took the guise of Freddy and chased me. Here's another recent example. When I started to practice again, I started to look for movies that had out-of-body experience, and then I got this movie called Insidious.
Yes.
Bad idea. So I went into an altered state. I'm on my way to getting out-of-body. I hit the theta state, and I see this being up perched in my ceiling just like in the movie. So the fact is, when we get into these meditative states and we get into these out-of-body states, it's very thought-responsive. So like you said, if you have negativity inside that you haven't dealt with, it could come to the surface and you can run into it. So it's possible to have negative experiences. But the difference I would say between that and drugs is that beyond a certain point, it doesn't get helpful anymore. Beyond a certain point, it just becomes a bad habit. So, I mean, there are some people who the first time they became aware of something greater is because they got a hit of whatever. And then they went on and started meditating and took it farther. But I would say with meditation, you could just keep on going and it doesn't become detrimental. But yes, you can have negative experiences because, I mean, you could run into your own projections. There's also negative entities out there. But as I started to become more in control of the experience, what I found is all you have to do is fly up. Like if you happen to be, the way the non-physical realms are structured in my experience is like a honeycomb. So that, like here in the physical world, you know, you go across the planet and it's like a flat plane. But in a non-physical dimension, if you fly up above the sky of where you are, it's the ground of a different dimension. Yes. And basically, the higher you go, the higher vibratory it becomes. So if you find yourself in a negative experience, just fly upward and you'll find yourself in ever finer dimensions. At least that's how it always worked for me. So and when you run into a non-physical being that's negative, they're... you're non-physical too. You're just as powerful. So you could either just fly away or you can beat them up. I mean, I actually spent time, you know, after that, Freddie actually spent a lot of time as a child literally seeking non-physical, negative non-physical entities. So there was a period of time when I literally consciously went into what's called the hellish realms. And I fought demons, what we call demons and ghouls, just to prove that I can do it. So and after that point, they never bothered me again because they knew, you know, if I saw somebody getting messed with, I would go beat it up and get it away from the person. So you know, you can have negative experiences, but once you take stock of yourself and realize how powerful you are, it's very easy to get beyond. The same thing with the LSD and the drugs, oh, they're holding it away from us. No one can stop us. The same thing with the technology that's dwarfing people's humanity, anybody can choose to put the technology down. So it always has to do with our own choice as an individual, and no matter what it is, we can overcome it.
No, that's perfect. I'm actually, when this show started, I actually thought we were just going to talk about out-of-body experiences and just them. And to be fair, the weird way the conversations drifted off into different ways, it's actually benefited it's benefited my theory and thoughts towards it all, because it all seems to correlate. It all seems to interlink, and it interlinks quite closely. Now, we had a question before, and it's something which I don't buy myself personally, but I'll ask the question. It's by Gary, where are we?
Bradfield?
Yeah, no, I'm just trying to find the question he put through. Come on, where are you? Do you know what? That's the worst part. We're having a chat room. No offense, guys. Everybody in the chat room, thanks for being there. But
See somebody while you're looking. You know, somebody asked about Shaolin monks from Tibet. Any meditative practice, I think we call different practices different names, but in the end, it's all about entering altered states, whatever technique you use. So yes, a Shaolin monk who goes into an altered state and can control their body or be peaceful no matter what, it's the same thing that you can do meditating on your own.
Okay. Right. Now, the question that's just appeared, I've just found it, right, and it's about reptilian. Now, I know everybody seems to have their own theories on what is and what isn't classified as something extraterrestrial, but he's stating, do you believe that reptile aliens are actually already here?
Yes, I do.
Do you? Right. And yes, what's brought you to that conclusion?
Just hearing accounts. Like one of the most telling accounts I've heard was like from the 90s, this lady named Pamela Stonebrook, and she had several contacts, and just hearing her contacts, I mean, I believed her, you know, and just hearing accounts of people seeing them. So I've never seen them myself. There's a whole lot of stuff that I don't get into. Like some people say they're behind the royal family and they're ruling the Illuminati, you know. I don't know about all that. But in my experience, every single genome type develops consciousness somewhere in the universe. Just in my research in extraterrestrial races, I mean, there's people who've seen insects, there's people who've seen, of course, there's the grays, there's people who've seen all different kind of beings that look so many different ways. Just very one person named Rodney Martin, he saw so many different kind of species, reptilian species, insect species, ant-like species, octopus-like species, fish-like species. So I think reptilians on some planet or at some time in the history of Earth, I think there's species of reptilians that are resentient. You know, but what their intentions are overall, I can't really say. You know, some people say they ran into negative ones. Some people say they saw them in Dulce based and it was working with the grays. You know, there's all kind of theories about what they're doing, but I do believe they exist. You know, there's a tribe called the Dogon who have sculptures from the past, old sculptures from, you know, they've passed stories down from their ancestors that they had these reptilian beings that visited them. You know, and they have sculptures that you can carbon date to show that they was older than the internet, for instance. So they didn't like just see it on the internet and make the sculpture, but these beings exist, these reptilians that walked on twos and communicated. So I believe they exist.
Right. You know, as a theory, as I said, I and this is only me, I'll have an open mind towards as much as I possibly can if I can see some form of proof or some form of like verifiable proof. Now, I've never seen any proof towards that. I'm not saying that it doesn't happen. I'm not saying it doesn't exist. What I have been told and what I have heard anecdotally and all the reports that I've read is that they're not exactly a very positive species. If they were anything, they were excessively negative and they were always not angry, but if they were a species out there, then everybody I seem to be in contact with who have spoke to it regards to it, have always said that as a breed, they are very, very negative, like angry.
Yeah, I've heard of a lot of accounts of being negative, aggressive. Aggressive. It's just never me being eating. But, you know, I mean, the fact is, if you look on planet Earth, just amongst the human race, there's a whole spectrum. There's Jesus and Mother Teresa, and there's Hitler. And there's a whole variety in between. So, you know what I mean? Yeah. So I think when we look out into the stars, it'll be the same way. You have some races that are predominantly a certain way. Like when you look into the American history, there was the Indians. They had an overall culture. And you have the Europeans had an overall culture. We're superior. We're going to take their stuff. We're going to enslave these people. So you're going to find different races, I think, extraterrestrial races. I mean, these people are not gods. They're not mystical. They're just different people that live on different planets. You know, so they're going to have different ways of thinking. They're going to have different personality types. They're going to be at different levels of psychological development.
I like what you're saying, Darryl, but my question is, you know, we're talking about the different types of I always do this, quotes, aliens and stuff like that. Now, let's say we go, you travel the universe, you traverse through the universe. Now, do aliens believe in a god? Now that's my question. Would an alien race believe in a god, or are they above that, or still at that level where there's something greater controlling all the, well, all one universe in some eyes and multiple universes in other eyes?
That's a very good question. In my experience, it runs the gamut. In my experience, I've I've learned through contactees of races of different planets that are similar to ours, where they have a religion and they believe they're the only species on Earth. And you have beasts like you have species like the Pleiadians who have the technology to bring themselves into a non-physical state where they can have access to the universal mind, what they call the unified. But to them, that's God, the universal mind that all of us are a part of. So yes, these beings do have ideas of creation and ideas of a higher power, and it affects the way that they live. So again, these beings are not different or special. You know, they're more or less advanced technologically, more or less advanced spiritually, and of course the ones that are visiting here are more advanced technologically, but you know, they have their beliefs and their outlooks as well. I think when I look at like the Sasani perspective and the Pleiadian perspective, I think they're a lot more accurate than ours. They look at it more like, rather than it being my God wrote this one book, the Bible, and it's the only right God and all y'all are going to hell, it's more like there's a universal mind that you can actually get in touch with in meditation yourself, and we're all a part of this universal mind, and we all are developing to the point where we can get back to alignment with that universal mind. So I think that's a good way to look at it. It's very practical.
Right.
Again, there's some planets that are just like us, you know, they have their things, you know.
Yeah. So there are actually planets out there which you've got idiots like us too.
Yes, there are. And of course, you know, I only know about that from accounts of people who get taken up on the craft or get from the contacts they've had, they're described other civilizations. But I mean, why would it not be that way? I mean, how can we believe that we're, you know, we've had this idea that we're the center of the universe for so long that we can't fathom the fact that there's some species that have been around for thousands of years older longer than us, and there's some species that are just coming into fruition right now. There's some species who are at our, you know, industrial age. You know, there's galaxies that are just being born. There's stars that are just being born. There's stars that's going supernova. So there's a whole gamut of species throughout the galaxy and throughout the universe. So I think once we expand our perspective to the point that we recognize that, then we'll be able to look at the situation in a very more objective way, which is why people like, you know, Stephen Hawking could have such a limited perspective to project the way that we live our lives on a society that's 1,000 years advanced to us. Yeah. I mean, you know, we don't have to believe that they're going to be like us and Indians.
You
know, chances are they've been around for 1,000 years and they have technology that can traverse space in seconds. Chances are, if they wanted to war, we'll be dead already, because we can look at what we do. If they live by our standards, we would be dead. You know,
we didn't waste
a moment. We gave the Indians blankets filled with smallpox. You know what I'm saying? We didn't waste a moment. We went to Africa, put them on boats, and brought them back. You know, we didn't waste a moment. They took the Jews, put them in concentration camps, and gassed them. We don't wait.
Yeah.
So if they had our way of thinking,
but
obviously they're not wanted to kill
us.
We are. You know?
Well, one thing I will say, because I'm going to move swiftly off this, because I want to start talking about your book, but just before I go off this subject, bear in mind, even smart people are stupid, and you said it before yourself, even smart people can be dumb, right? The guy who invented the first locomotive or the first train was killed by his own train. That's all I'm saying. It ran him over. What a dipshit. So anyway, moving swiftly on, right, we're going to move on to rather lovable new thing.
And if I can, let me make sure I answer one question, because I had mentioned on Facebook or somebody had a question, and a lady asked about a cat that she think might have been a reincarnation of someone. In my experience, reincarnation happens, but in my experience, humans don't reincarnate as animals. If you read the works of Robin Monroe, he's come across a consciousness that was once an animal that was going to be incarnated as a human.
Yeah.
But I've never heard of humans reincarnating an animal. So to the lady who asked that question, I would say that cat is just, you know, in my experience and in my research, animals that we take as pets reflect a lot of the thoughts of the humans that are around them or that are their masters. So I would say that cat is just reflecting the thinking of the humans around it. I don't think it's a human reincarnated as an animal. I think animals can reincarnate as humans at a certain point.
Okay, let's go to your book, Darryl, real quick.
Okay.
We got it up on screen right here.
Awesome.
I mean, tell us about your book. Tell us what research you did about the book, and where we could find the book, what's in the book without blowing anything out, because the goal is ultimately to get your idea out there through your book and through different talk shows or different forms of media. So tell us about your book a little bit.
Awesome. Well, it shares several out-of-body experiences. I first started having out-of-body experiences about 30 ago. You know, I didn't practice consistently through that period of time, but I've had several experiences. You know, I've met the dead. I went into outer space. I went to alternate timelines. I went into the past. I went into the future. I've met other out-of-body explorers and confirmed it. I've seen other people out-of-body and confirmed it. So the first half of the book is my experiences. I list a lot of the experiences that I've had, and so you can see what the experience is like. And the second half of the book, I give all the technique and theory. So, you know, over the years, I've taught many, many people. And in 2012, I had a research study that's called, okay, that I call, and what I did was I took about a dozen people stuck with it, and I taught a group of people how to have the out-of-body experience. And at the end of a two-month period, about six out-of-body experiences were had, one had right after the experience, right after the study ended. But everybody in the study, they either had an out-of-body experience, or they was at a point where I knew if they kept practicing, they would have it. They was having altered state experiences like imagery and vibrations. They were on their way. So basically, all the experience and the research I've done, I've condensed it and codified it, so you don't have to do all that research, and you can read it and you can learn how to have the experience. I've also quit.
No, keep going. I was just going to follow up with what you were saying. You did a beginner's guide. I've noticed that your first book here is a beginner's guide.
That's right.
Are we working, not me and you, but are we, you, working on a second book as a follow-up to those who have finished the first book that want to even get delved in deeper to what, you know, you were talking about in book number one?
So, yeah, I'm working on a second book called Galactic Travels, where I plan on going out and exploring space a bit more and exploring these different civilizations. And I'm also doing a second, I did that first research study where I validated the techniques with a concentrated group. And what I'm doing now is a second research study where I'm meeting with more advanced projectors, and I'm going out of body, and we're going to meet each other. And I'll have some more advanced techniques for people who want to, you know, do more advanced travels. But really, all the techniques that you needed in the first book, I would say the future ones will mostly be giving you more examples of how you can push the limits of travel, and I plan on updating the techniques as we go along. But yes, I do plan on having future books where, let's say, I have more advanced techniques of when you're out of body. Let me make sure you know how to get to this dimension. Let me make sure how you know how to get to through time and so on and so forth. You know, there's only so much you can put into one book. But like I said, it's the beginner's guide where people can learn how to get out of body. They can learn how to go here and there. They can learn how to visit dead relative, and you can get your feet wet with the experience. And for people who want as well, that 2 month study, I turned it into a 2 month course. I also have a course for people who are interested in having more hands on instruction, but everything that you need is in the book. But you know, I plan on having a few books that I put out, depending on how demand for it is, you know.
Do you have any lectures coming up? Are you going? Do you have anything in the woodwork right now?
I don't have any lectures coming up. I'm still pretty new to the game, and I'm still getting pretty known. So I guess right now I'm just trying to work up my exposure, because I think about advertise for a lecture. I don't think I'm so known right now where a lot of people will come. So I'm trying to just do more interviews and do more talks. Like, I have a few more talks scheduled for next month. But I do would like to do that. My company is called Next Density, and I actually intend on ultimately having a center where people could come from near or far, and they'll have classes and courses on out-of-body travel. We should already do a course on out-of-body travel and classes and courses on all of this stuff, on altered states and meditation and meeting extraterrestrials. Like, for instance, right now, I'm also doing a research study where I'm reinitiating contact with extraterrestrials. So, you know, pretty much I'm about progressing humanity. I'm about doing my part to help progress humanity. But again, as I said, you can't really make anybody change, but by following my joy and by doing the best I can, I know that I would help align myself with a timeline where I align with more people who are interested into that. So I have research that is going where I'm delving deeper into these things. I have education courses where I teach people these things, and also I'll get into development where I try to help develop free energy technologies and things like that. So ultimately, in the end, I want my life to be helping people to develop and progress and accentuate the greater part of ourselves, so we can, as the saying goes, use more of our brain, use more of our capacity by accessing these altered states and by letting go of fear and getting more into who and what we really are. I mean, I really see us as a race of beings that will be traversing space. You know, we will be traversing space. We will be a peaceful society. We will recognize ourselves as one people. And part of it has to do with, one, practicing ourselves, developing ourselves, and two, sharing with others and helping everybody else along. So it's an interconnected thing.
You seem to live basically the way you're coming across right now is you live PMA. It's what we grew up in D.C. calling positive mental attitude. That one, I was an old punk rocker and this old band called the Bad Brains used to live through PMA, positive mental attitude. And it seems like with the meditation, with everything else going on, the way you're focusing your life right now, you're definitely going through with a positive mental attitude. And I can see that benefiting a lot of people who do have open minds, because you are going to find a lot of closed minds elsewhere. But, you know, you do seem to live the PMA lifestyle, which is really cool.
Definitely, because it's just happier. I mean, it's just happier, man. I just try to focus on what I can change for the better, which is, of course, really myself. And I just try to help. And really, that's what it's about. I mean, if we change ourselves the best we can, because the world is only what we make it. One analogy I like to use is if you have a bucket and you fill it with a lot of blue-colored balls, they don't suddenly turn green because a bunch of them are in the bucket. Like a lot of people say, you know, like it was in that movie Men in Black, you know, the individual is smart, but people as a whole are dumb. Well, you know what? Yeah. People as a whole are just a bunch of individual people. You know, so if we change ourselves individually, we make the whole. We collectively make the whole, so that's the first step. And the fact is, if we look at things from a negative perspective, from a victimhood perspective, like I get that a lot, you know, the reason why more people are not into this is because the media is not putting this stuff out, and the reason why it's like this is because the government is doing this. And no, those are just a handful of people. You know, if we all decided, you know what, I want a different world, let's work together and make it, it will be that way. So I used to try to change people and get people to, but people didn't want to go. But then I realized, am I really doing it? How positive am I being? I'm so angry at the government, you know, because they're angry at them and blowing them up. Well, why don't I work on my anger? You know, and then I can at least be an example that you don't have to be angry and go blow up Iraq and take their oil or whatever you want to do. We could be at peace. So that's what it's really about, you know. So you know, at the least, I want to be a place of positivity and peace in myself. And I'm not saying I succeed all the time. I still get angry and frustrated, but I'll tell you what, every time I do, I work on it, and I recognize that nothing outside of me can make me angry. Nothing outside of me can limit me. It's all up to my own choices, the way I think, and I'm the primary doer in my experience. And as I do that more and more, I start to look at the world differently. You know, the reason why we look at the world and we see it so negative is really because of negativity in us. Like the more I change myself, even the negative things in the world, I see it differently. Because everything is serving someone. Everything is serving someone. You know, everything. Yeah. Even if it's just the service of recognizing that even though such and such happened, okay, my parents treated me horribly when I was a kid. You know, but guess what? I can look at myself now and decide right now. I don't have to let that continue to influence me. And then we can apply that as the next thing comes up. So, you know, the fact is we live on a planet that's a very mixed bag. You know, like I said, we have Jesus and Mother Teresa and Buddha, and we have Hitler and Pol Pot. And there's a mixture in between. But guess what? Mother Teresa saw everyone as a child of God. Now, again, we could talk about her theology. I'm not a Catholic, and I don't really care. I just look at her, and I see she was a very peaceful lady. She took her theology, whatever it was, and she applied it so purely. And, you know, she's going out there helping homeless people and picking people up. When the average person would be like, I'm going to get away from that person. You stink. I don't want to touch you. That's love right there. So can we do that? Can we look at ourselves? And the more I do that, I see that the world is actually more kinder than I thought it was. I thought the world was so unkind because I was so unkind. And the more kind I become, the more kind the world seems to be to me, because I interpret it differently because I'm looking at it from a different place. So, like I said, it does help me a lot, and it's helping me to see the world differently. And I don't care what anybody else does, man. I'm not going to stop.
Right on, man. No, do you know what? Right on. Can I give you? I'm going to give you the virtual high five, the best way to call it, right? Normally we speak to people on the show, what happens is we'll speak to them and they'll tell us, you know, they'll give us their opinion on something, right? Nobody's ever came on and said, I don't give a crap, this is the way I want to do it, right? And that's perfect. I like that. I like the fact that you will do it. I like the fact that you have pursued something which people look at with stigma anyway, because it's the same as, I mean, I investigate the paranormal, and Kate's the same as me, runs around houses with torches trying to find something in shadows, right? We get looked at by the outside world as idiots. Fact. Even though they're the closed-minded individuals who look at it and go, right, you're running to a house, there's nothing there. Well, can you prove it? No, but can you? And it's a redundant argument which we fought for a long time, for years, for no point. But you know what? It, as I said, take it as a compliment that the fact that you don't give two short ones what anybody believes, and the fact that you are doing it, and the fact that you have your beliefs and you hold on to your beliefs as strong as you do, that is a massive credit to yourself. When I, as I said, when we first,
not a belief. That's why. It's just like I was saying to you, like you were saying about the ETs, like you can't really, you know, say for sure. You see them a different way. I said, what did I say? I said, test it. I said, research people's contacts. So that's why I can be firm. It's not because I believe. It's because I'm basing it on direct experience. I'm basing it on direct research. So it's not a belief at all. It's just that I'm certain if anybody applies these techniques and travel far, you will have this experience. And I'm certain that if anybody tests the experience, like I said, I've gone out of body and I've met people and got out of body and got in body and confirmed it. So when somebody comes up to me and say, hey, you're just dreaming, that's nothing, I say, okay, bye. I don't have to argue with you because I know. Why don't you try it and you'll see. You know, so that's all it really takes, man. The same thing with ETs. Somebody can tell me, oh, how do you know ETs are real? Well, I called them telepathically and they came and I saw them. That's how I know. How do you know they're not real? You know, can you prove? I can. You know, I tell you what. You come with me, and I will show you. No one has ever taken me up on it. So the fact is, if you want to know, you can know. You can know. So, and that's where I'm at. I'm about knowing. So if you test it, you practice it, and you test it. You know, the same thing with peace.
Yeah,
I was where the person you at. I was trying to change people and convince people. I just realized it didn't work. You know, so I gave it up. You know, so and that's where I'm at. That's where I'm at. You know, it's not because I'm more spiritual or different. It's just because I tried it and it didn't work. But I know that I can always fall back on my direct experience, and I can always fall back on collaboration and comparing with other people's experiences. And like I said, now I'm taking it to another level where I'm getting a group of people, and we're going out of body consciously and meeting each other and confirming it. So, you know, there's no space for the naysayer. You know, if you want to know, you practice these techniques and then you will see for yourself. Oh, I'm not going to do that. Well, bye. You know, I don't have time for you. You know, that's where I'm at.
I like that idea. I like, because you basically, before we close out here, you're basically just, and plus part of what you're doing, and I think a lot of people don't do it, is you just take do not take responsibility in life and say, hey, it's up to me. You know, and you're doing that. You're saying, it's up to me. And I see that a lot. If I mess up, I'll be like, my bad, my apologies. It ain't going to happen again. You know, but at the same time, it's about taking responsibility for yourself, I think, for your own actions, for what you want to do to better yourself. And you'll never change anybody's views. I mean, you've seen that on Facebook, multimedia. Nobody, you know, you see it in politics. Nobody's going to change their mind. You know, so it's just taking personal responsibility, and I like that a lot.
Right. Yeah. And I'm fine with them having their way, because there's enough alternate earths where everybody can have their way. So as long as I focus on my way, I'm sure I'll experience more of that, you know?
Right on.
Well, first things first, as I said, or last thing, last, sorry, we're going to have to call it a day. We're coming right to the end of the show. Now, what I am going to say is you've got a full open invitation for when your next book's finished to come on, and just come on and... I mean, normally we have a structure towards the show. We try to have a few questions in place and try and have a sort of a way the show's going to run, and it always falls to crap. Always, always. Literally, we have a plan. We rip the plan apart, and nothing ever comes of it. But I've actually really enjoyed the conversation we've had, because it's been a testing conversation. It's not just what do you believe. It's been a conversation where you could be honest and say, I don't think what you're saying is right, and where I've came along and said, well, you know, I'm naive towards it, but this is my theory, and you know what, I've really enjoyed the conversation, so thank you very much for coming on. Thanks very much for everything.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Darryl.
Right, awesome. And before we go, I'm going to let everybody know, right, you're losing me next week, sorry, not my fault. Well,
it's alright, you got me on next week.
Yeah, you don't need me.
Yeah, we do. You're going to be in Cyprus lying in a thong on the beach just to show off to everybody.
I am going to be sprawled out like Fabio. on a beach. Or a beach ride, maybe. But that's my dog attacking me. But nevertheless, right, so for the next 2 weeks, we are going to lose me. Well, you're going to lose me, but you're going to gain Adam O'Rourke next week, and Stephen Foy will be coming on the week after. So before we go, finally, just to point out, again, a great massive thank you to Darryl Benny for coming on.
Yeah, but before thanks, we go, Aaron.
Any further, present to everybody. Go to his website, which is nextdensity.com. Have a little look at the courses that he's got on. Some of the courses look absolutely phenomenal. I'm going to rip through them myself. And finally, DarrylBerryJr.com, which is a site all about Darryl Berry, all about his book and all about the initiative, the contact initiative, and his OBE research. Please go on there and don't just say you're going to do it, guys. Go on there. If you don't, I'm pretty sure there's not much protection you can get because he will probably come and find you, and I don't blame him in the slightest. I'll come without him. So, guys, on that absolute and utter footnote, I'm going to say good night and see you guys again soon. Take it easy, guys.
Have a good night.
Bye-bye now. Bye-bye.